This video is sponsored by Ecovax. Tesla's recent announcement during Investor Day suggests they may be about to break the electric motor industry with a new permanent magnet motor design that's smaller, lighter, cheaper, and more efficient than what they use today, all without having any rare earth metals. This breakthrough will mean a dramatic reduction in price for all future Tesla models, and it could also mean less dependency on China for raw materials. But neodymium and other rare earth metals are the strongest magnets you can buy, right? Is there something groundbreaking afoot, or is Tesla just shooting for the stars to boost their stock price? Let's find out. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. New electric motors and battery technologies are the basis of modern electric vehicles. Without the high energy and power densities of new batteries like lithium-ion batteries, lithium iron phosphate, and other chemistries we've covered before on this channel, batteries just simply would be too heavy and bulky for EVs to carry around. In fact, the maximum energy density of lithium-ion batteries has increased over 20 times since 2008, back when it was a meager 55 watt-hours per liter, compared to the record holder today, which is Amperes Tech's 1150 watt-hour per liter / 450 watt-hours per kilogram battery, which they recently shipped to a company building next-generation high-altitude pseudo-satellites or cutting-edge stratospheric platforms. Which kind of reminds me of the Chinese balloon video that we made, links in the description. A 20-fold increase in energy density means that batteries are now 20 times smaller than in 2008 for the same amount of stored energy. But an equally important part of the EV equation is the electric motor that converts the energy stored in those batteries into motion. An ideal motor for an EV needs lots of torque so it can accelerate quickly. It needs to be powerful enough and able to withstand high RPMs to move a heavy car at a wide range of speeds. It also needs to be lightweight and small. It needs to be cheap so it doesn't drive the cost of the entire vehicle up. And it should also be easy to manufacture. And finally, it should be made of easily accessible materials. The first three conditions define the performance of the motor and are met by having good power and torque densities. And all six conditions depend heavily on the particular design of the motor, and that's what we're going to focus on today. To understand that better, let's look at how electric motors work. From a general point of view, all electric motors work in much the same way. You have two main components to an electric motor. The stator, which is the part of the motor that stays fixed, or static, hence the name, and the rotor, which, as you probably already guessed, is a part that spins or rotates. The stator creates an electromagnetic field by passing a current through a series of loops or copper windings, and that magnetic field pushes on a second magnetic field coming from the rotor, pushing and pulling on it and making it spin. The main aspect of the motor that changes from one design to another are how the rotors generate its magnetic field, either through permanent magnets, through copper coils, or through induced currents in a conductor, and the type of current, AC or DC, used to generate the electromagnetic fields. Tesla hasn't only been at the forefront of new battery tech with their 4680 cells that are among the best in its class, but the company is also spearheading an electric motor industry with new permanent magnet motor designs powered by a new type of powerful magnet that doesn't use rare earth metals like neodymium, dysprosium, or terbium. Now, when I saw this at Investor Day, it really caught my attention. I mean, we've grown so accustomed to considering neodymium magnets as the be-all, end-all when it comes to powerful permanent magnets, that so much as questioning them as the industry standard seemed counterintuitive. So let's take a look at what Tesla has been up to. Tesla has been innovating the EV industry since day one, and that meant revolutionizing everything from the entire manufacturing process to each individual component, starting with the motor. It's pretty amazing how quickly some of these technologies are advancing, especially in areas like AI and robotics, where Tesla is investing heavily, and that's a great segue to our sponsor this week. Ecovax is the innovative robot vacuum company, and this is their D-Bot T10 Omni. The T10 Omni not only has LiDAR to map your home, establish rooms, and vacuum in the most efficient way possible, but now it has cameras and, combined with their object avoidance AI technology, can sense the common household items you may have and avoid them. But this isn't just high tech. It's also an impressive vacuum. With its five-stage cleaning system, 5,000 pascals of suction force, and filters to catch even the finest debris. But the one feature I still can't get over is their mopping system. The Osmo Turbo 2 rotating mopping system features a dual spinning mop that spins 180 times every minute for an incredibly accurate stain removal process. The Auto Everything Omni Station has bins for clean and dirty water, and it cleans itself after each session and even has dryer pads to keep the mop heads clean and dry between sessions. The T10 Omni also empties its dust bin and holds up to 75 days of dust, making it incredibly low maintenance. It even has a voice assistant called Eco that you can talk to. About to join a video call? just say, okay, Eco, stop cleaning.
Cleaning paused.
Its video system even lets you check in on your house and pets while you're away. So take back your time and let the Ecovax D-Bot T10 Omni do the cleaning for you. Links in the description. Huge thanks to Ecovax and you for supporting the show. The first Tesla ever made back in 2008, the Tesla Roadster, sported a 185 kilowatt AC induction motor. The induction motor was invented by Serbian-American inventor Nikola Tesla back in 1887, which is how the company originally got its name. In fact, did you know that the Tesla logo is actually a cross-section of the electric induction motor Nikola Tesla invented? Elon Musk confirmed it himself on a tweet a few years ago. AC induction motors have some things going for them. They're very efficient, which means they're good at converting the energy coming from the battery pack into mechanical energy or motion. They provide high torque at low speeds, and they're relatively inexpensive. While AC induction motors are a popular choice for electric vehicles, they do have some disadvantages compared to other types of motors. Some of the cons include lower efficiency at low speeds, lower acceleration than other options because of lower torque overall, and they're also slightly noisier and tend to cause more vibrations in the car. Tesla has moved on from the induction motor to use permanent magnetic AC motors, or PMACs. PMACs work similarly to standard AC motors, with the only difference being that the magnetic field from the rotor isn't induced by the stator, but rather generated by a permanent magnet embedded near the surface of the rotor. The cool thing about these motors is that if you use really strong magnets, you can make really strong motors. But the problem was that strong magnets used to be very big. It wasn't until strong neodymium magnets were developed back in 1982 that we could make PMACs smaller and their power density started to increase significantly enough to make them useful for EV applications, as this following chart shows. So what makes these permanent magnet AC motors great? The main perk is that they have a very high power density, which means that they can produce more power in a smaller and lighter package. This makes them obviously ideal for use in EVs where weight and size are critical factors. They're more efficient than AC induction motors as well, especially at low speeds, which means you can get more range out of your car for the same charge. While they do have less torque at low speeds than induction motors, they have higher torque at high speeds, which is more important for maintaining high speeds and cruising. The problem with these types of motors is that they have lower torque at low speed, making them accelerate slower. So it takes longer to go from 0 to 60. The second big problem is that they need strong magnets, and until today, that has meant rare earth magnets like neodymium, iron, boron magnets. These magnets represent a problem for two reasons. Rare earths are expensive. Most of the rare earths today are mined and processed in China. This makes high power density PMACs, like the ones needed for EVs, expensive, and their supply chain is dependent on geopolitical conditions and the relationships between China and the US, which are somewhat in a delicate spot right now, to say the least. Today, Tesla designs cars that get the best of both worlds by combining induction and permanent magnet motors on their drivetrains. The Tesla Model 3 and Y sport AC permanent magnet synchronous motors for the rear wheels and AC induction motors for the front. This lets them get better performance both at low and high speeds. In the case of the Tesla Model S, the original model had a three-phase, four-pole AC induction motor. In 2019, it switched to the Raven powertrain, which used permanent magnet reluctance motors from the Tesla Model 3, and now uses the AC permanent magnet synchronous motor, just like the Tesla Model X. This clearly shows that Tesla is betting for permanent magnet AC motors, despite their downsides. The reason, it seems, is because they have a new AC motor design that'll cut down costs so significantly that the entire drivetrain will only cost about $1,000 in the new generation platforms. And they're doing this by getting rid of rare earth metals, changing the state of design, and simplifying the manufacturing process. At Investor Day, Colin Campbell, in charge of powertrain, mentioned how the company managed to reduce the weight of the powertrain by 20%, using 25% less rare earth materials and making the powertrain factory 75% smaller and 65% cheaper to build between 2017 and 2022. Now for the next generation motors, they're going big or going home by completely avoiding rare earth magnets altogether. This image from the Investor Day event shows the underside of a stator from a 2022 Model 3 drivetrain with the typical round welds that close the loop circuits. Regardless of the new stator design, induction motors aren't how Tesla plans to get rid of rare earth, because Colin Campbell specifically stated that the next generation motor would be a permanent magnet motor. So what does this mean? Well, there's basically two options. Either Tesla is reverting back to a bigger, less power-dense magnet like the ones used in speakers, or they found a new magnetic material that can produce at scale that's as good or better than neodymium magnets, but without the rare earth metals. The first scenario is plausible. They could afford to put a larger magnet by making the rest of the motor lighter and smaller, which is something Tesla has been accomplishing successfully for the past few years. This decision could make it easy to scale production to 20 million EVs as they plan to do. But I don't think this is the case. I mean, it's not like Tesla to go for lower quality just for the sake of cost. In fact, almost all the speakers at the Investor Day pointed out how the company's vertical integration allowed them to lower costs while also improving the performance of the end product. So I think what really happened was that Tesla found a clear path to source a new type of magnet that's as good or better than rare earth magnets, but without the rare earth materials. As it turns out, that material already exists, and we've known about it for decades. I'm talking about a special type of iron compound called iron nitride. Iron nitride magnets are made of only two elements, iron and nitrogen. Iron is the fourth most abundant element in the Earth's crust, making up about 5% of it, but it makes up around 80 to 85% of the entire Earth's mass, so we won't be running out of iron anytime soon. Nitrogen, on the other hand, is the most abundant element in the atmosphere, making up about 78% of the air we breathe. So if we can make magnets out of these two elements, we'll have nearly endless supplies of powerful magnets for all applications. So the question really then is, how good a magnet could you actually make with iron nitride? And how does it compare with a traditional neodymium magnet? Well, the strength of a permanent magnet is measured through something called the maximum energy product, or HB max. This quantity is a measure of the maximum amount of magnetic energy that can be stored in a magnet per unit volume. A typical ferrite magnet, those black ceramic magnets like the ones that we've seen on refrigerators, have an energy product of about 8 to 45 kilojoules per meter cubed, with the best of them reaching about 80 kilojoules per meter cubed. In contrast, high-grade neodymium magnets labeled N52 have a maximum energy product of 400 to 422 kilojoules per meter cubed. That's over 10 times higher than the typical ferrite magnet. But iron nitride magnets go way beyond that, with a theoretical maximum energy product of over 1,000 kilojoules per meter cubed. This is almost three times higher than the best neodymium magnet today. This means that we could make magnets 2.5 times smaller, but with the same magnetic force. Not only that, but iron nitride has a density of 6.35 grams per centimeter cubed, while the typical neodymium magnet has a density of 7.6 grams per centimeter cubed, which means that not only is the size much smaller, but the mass will be even lower still. Additionally, some reports state that the material's magnetization can withstand higher temperatures, with a Curie temperature of around 1300 Kelvin, whereas for neodymium magnets, the Curie temperature barely reaches half as much. So iron nitride makes stronger, lighter, and smaller magnets that can withstand higher temperatures without demagnetizing. So you're probably thinking, this recent discovery is going to change everything. But in fact, it's not so recent at all. In fact, it was discovered back in 1951, over 70 years ago. So natural question then is, why the heck aren't we using iron nitride magnets on everything? Well, the answer is that it's very hard to make this stuff, especially at scale. The specific compound we need to make has the formula Fe16N2, but getting the formula right is only part of the equation. These compounds have to form a specific magnetic phase. It's kind of like tempering steel. You can have all the components in the right amounts, but you have to apply a very special treatment to get the steel you want. Well, the same applies for iron nitride. However, some researchers at the University of Minnesota apparently cracked the code. They started a spin-off company called Niron Magnetics to commercialize their technology, and I have to say, it looks pretty promising. The company is developing what they have called clean earth magnets based on iron nitride. This technology enables the mass production of high-performance permanent magnets using low-cost and sustainable input materials. According to the company, their magnets are 15 to 30% stronger than neodymium. They perform better as temperatures rise and don't contain any rare earth materials. And they claim that they have figured out how to produce the material at scale. Dusty Green, our producer, actually heard about Niron Magnetics a few months ago and thought it might be worth checking out to see if what they claimed on their website was actually true. It turned out that Niron was very secretive and keeping pretty hush-hush about their development stage, but he confirmed they are building a large manufacturing facility across the street from their headquarters. The research team behind Niron Magnetics has published 23 research papers on iron nitride's magnetic properties and synthesis since 2009. So their technology is based on over a decade of research and development conducted by their team of scientists and engineers, which includes a whole lot of PhDs. They also have 30 patents granted and 20 more pending approval. And Neuron Magnetics secured a $17.5 million scale-up grant from the U.S. Department of Energy's Advanced Research Projects Agency and the National Science Foundation, which suggests that their commercial technology has undergone some level of third-party validation. All of this suggests that Neuron Magnetics is the real deal, and the fact that they are building a production facility is more encouraging. But what's more interesting is that, for me, the physics check out. Remember, I mentioned that the theoretical strength of these magnets was almost three times as high as neodymium, so achieving a 30% increase seems more than doable. This means that the clean energy magnets from Neuron Magnetics could be the first of a whole new family of permanent clean magnets that can make electric motors smaller and more powerful than ever before. Picture a standard skateboard with little motors on each wheel that could keep you going without moving a muscle, or an e-bike that's almost indistinguishable from a regular one because the motor is the size of a gear cassette. And the best part of all is cost. High-grade neodymium magnets are super expensive, as you can imagine, because neodymium costs almost $200 per kilogram. Dysprosium costs $600, and terbium, $800 per kilogram, whereas iron costs less than $1 per kilogram. Of course, there will be high production costs because the iron nitride is hard to make, but Neuron claims that their magnets will still be 50% cheaper than neodymium. So all in all, it seems like this is exactly the kind of technology that Tesla would be investing in. Tesla has made huge strides with batteries. We haven't heard as much about motors, but here it is. This is a huge win from an environmental standpoint, performance, cost, and complexity, simpler supply chains, and all the rest. Exactly the sort of thing that Tesla should be investing in for their next generation of products. So what do you guys think? Did I miss something? Do you have any other insights that we might have overlooked? Sound off in the comments below. And until next week, check out this video, which we think you'll like as well. I'm Ricky, this is Tuba Da Vinci. We'll catch you guys next week.